If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode, this welcome back episode.
Hey, we were off for a minute.
We're here.
Mind Pump. We actually took like a week off.
So where would you go? Reno, Hawaii, or Alaska?
Yeah, we're shaking off. We shook off the,
I feel like a loser.
The podcast dust with this episode. So for the first 24 minutes.
Little mic rust.
Yeah, for the first 24 minutes there, we had some good warm-up conversation.
Felt like riding a bike.
Yeah. A unicycle. Justin went to Reno. The worst whoop, place whoop. Of all the
I fucking need to hype this up a little bit.
I went to Kauai, the beautiful island of Kauai, and Adam went to Alaska. We all had some interesting adventures. I hiked a bunch of awesome stuff. Adam saw some incredible wilderness, and Justin had too much weed.
I bought weed legally.
Stay away from the food on the cruises. Yeah. There's like cafeteria foods. So live off your green juice.
That's right. Adam had to use a lot of his Organifi green juice because he didn't have access to lots of vegetables. By the way, if you want to try out Organifi's green juice, go to OrganifiShop.com. Enter the code MindPump for a discount. Then we get into the fitness questions. The first question was, how do you differentiate between hunger that is real hunger or just like a craving or emotional hunger? We talk a little bit about that. Then we answer the question on advice for long distance relationships. I know you think you're listening to a fitness podcast, but we're actually experts on everything.
Yeah.
So we talk about relationships there. Then someone asks us a question. Do we think it's legitimate that in order to be great at a sport, you need to start at a very young age? Is that true? Or can you be great if you start much later on? For example, I'm going to start playing football now, and I'm going to prove this wrong by becoming...
You have no chance.
...great at throwing the football. Then the
like
final
a dart.
Exactly. Yeah. Then the final question is, how do you deal with performance anxiety? We all have a lot of advice on that, and we talk about all kinds of performance anxiety. Not just the filthy type that you're thinking right now. Also, it's closeout. 2 days left. There's only 2 days left for what's turning out to be our biggest promotion yet. We're giving access to our private forum for free if you enroll in any MAPS program or in any of our bundles. Right now, one of our more popular bundles is our Sexy Athlete Bundle. I've actually seen quite a few of those come up. The Sexy Athlete Bundle is taking MAPS Aesthetic and melding it with MAPS Performance with a mod that teaches you how to combine the two. And what it's doing is it's teaching you to be extremely functional while training for aesthetics as well. So if you're kind of like a bodybuilder, physique competitor, bikini type person, but you also like that functional type of stuff, this is for you. Or if you're that functional person, if you love doing the CrossFit stuff, you love doing hiking, mountain climbing sports, but you also want the aesthetics, this is also for you. So if you enroll in that or you enroll in any of our other programs, you'll get access to our forum.
If you want to look like Bo Jackson.
For free. what?
Because I do.
Also, the price for the forum is going up in
Lost
2 days
all the millennials.
As well. So not only are you getting free access, but it's going to go up in price anyway. So seriously, take advantage of this promotion. You can find it at mindpumpmedia.com.
And it's t-shirt time.
T-shirt time.
We like to bribe people.
Do we have
we had like 5 million reviews.
A record reviews this week, Doug?
Yeah, we had 46, I believe.
Holy,
46
holy shit.
Last week.
Oh, this is last week.
This 46 week, reviews. Not quite so good.
Oh, really?
How many this week?
We had 9.
How do we go from 43 to 9?
I'll 46. Tell you exactly what. Why.
Tell me.
You guys went on vacation. And when you guys go on vacation,
they miss us.
We get the reviews.
They miss us.
Come back to us.
We're back.
Let me remind people real quick how to leave a review. And again, you win a free t-shirt if you leave a 5-star review, and we pick your review if we like it.
Can we break the 43 record, Sal? I don't know.
46 or 43?
43, 46. I don't remember.
All right. It doesn't matter.
What?
Here's what you do. Even if you're subscribed to us, you got to do this in order to leave a review. Go click on your icon for your podcast. You go to the search function, type in Mind Pump. Mind Pump comes up. Click on the icon. Then you'll see a little thing that says review. Click on review. Then leave a 5-star review so that you can win one of these limited edition Mind Pump t-shirts.
You can win.
All right, Doug, who's the winners?
All right, we're going to give out three shirts this week. We have Okie Bum 23, Chris H 262, Enough 187. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com, your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
We are on fire.
When I...
In fuego.
I'm going to share some personal stuff here.
Oh, I can't wait.
When I left, for my
trip. Dude, did you guys see that? Wow. Did you see the photos that I posted from Alaska?
I did,
dude.
Amazing. Epic.
They were beautiful.
Postcards.
Absolutely beautiful.
Posting postcards.
What I was going to say is, because I want to talk, all about these
shirts. Yeah, I did go to Reno, actually.
Did you see our boy, Ryan?
Yep, he hooked it up, man. I went to, you know, the fight and everything. Got to watch Connor. And
downstairs in the bottom room where they do the big screen and everything, did they set it up down like that?
Up in the ballroom, yeah.
How was it?
Oh, it was cool.
Food, drink.
We sat in the very front. There's three screens going. Packed crowd. Crazy, dude. Connor came to fight, man. That was a good fight.
Very, very surprised.
What were you going to say, Sal?
Mayweather should be embarrassed.
Yeah.
I think so. Because I expected him to fully dominate hard. And he didn't really do that until...
Well, he wanted to claim that Connor was all tired. Part of his game plan,
did you,
right?
Yeah. Did you... I go back and forth on did he intentionally kind of do that, right? Like he didn't even throw a punch for the first round, I don't think.
Yeah.
First round, he like literally did not throw a punch. I think he didn't throw a punch till the very, very end of the...
He was trying to wear him out for sure.
And then Connor got exhausted.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when he lost.
Yeah. You'd think that Connor would have picked up on that though more. Like if he's just like waiting for him to just like waste all his energy.
Yeah. I think, I'll tell you what.
The ducking and all that shit though, you know, he was turtling away from him. That was pissing me off.
Is this true? Because someone told me that there was a press conference where Connor said, this is before the fight, the rematch will be in the cage. And Mayweather's like, you got it.
Mm-hmm.
That ain't happening.
You know, I highly doubt it.
Yeah, no, it's not.
But you don't think they would do it for another fucking massive payday?
No, I don't think Mayweather would.
Dude, Mayweather would never do that.
Yeah, he would never do it. I mean, look at the fact
that $100 million?
He would get killed. Not even for $100 million. I mean, I think that he made $300 million on this fight.
Oh my god.
Yeah, $300 million.
It's insane. It's insane.
Fucking insane.
Yeah.
For one, I told Katrina, I'll fight anybody. Yeah. You guys hear that? Anybody. I will fight the scariest, most deadliest motherfucker on this earth for $300 million.
Dude, for $300 million, I'll fight a shark in the water.
I was going to say, put me in the ring with a fucking polar bear, dude. I will fight.
In water.
I'll fight anything for that. That's ridiculous, dude.
You know what I'm saying?
I mean, you got kind of a chance, right?
Like
poke him in the eye or something.
Yeah, exactly. Son of a bitch.
That would suck.
You could buy a whole new body for that.
You could
buy a lot of bodies. Ooh. My bad. So what I was going to say,
a sex trafficker.
Justin, did you go to, you went to Reno with, you went to Reno with your best friends?
Yeah, from high school. Yeah. I mean, it probably was longer than
and,
that.
It was
even.
Just you and a bunch of dudes?
Just me and two dudes. We broed out. That was all we did.
Oh, yeah, wow.
We broed out the whole weekend. So I was up there for like 4 days. Yeah.
Do you have any cannabis?
We did.
Isn't it legal there now? You
it
just
is.
Buy it over the
because
counter?
It's legal. It's recreational.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
Did you overdo it?
Maybe. I'm not used to this whole you go in for a card and you get like real stuff. You know what I mean? Like, oh my god. And so I was out in public and it was. I was like losing my train of thought. I like couldn't. Talk. I couldn't order a drink. I was like, we got to go back to the casino, dude. This is getting ugly. And I wasn't alone, too. I was looking and we were just, everything was moving super slow, dude. And so anyway, yeah, that was one of those things. You're just like, I'm a rookie in this department. I not know what I'm doing.
I'm surprised that even happened to you, considering how many times you've hung out with me and Adam.
True.
I would figure your tolerance would be
well,
better.
Edibles I can handle. Like I had a really good chocolate. It was like a it had like espresso in it, so it was like perfect because it like a little bit of a stimulant there, so that was money, dude.
Fuck.
I know.
I missed you guys.
I did miss you guys too.
That's what I was going to say earlier when Adam interrupted me.
I know.
It was a touching thing I was
going
to say.
Keep going though. You got to power through it.
Well, when I left.
No, did you go
for my
did you
trip,
have your did see, you guys
well, this cocksucker keeps doing this shit.
Come on, Sal. You got to power through it, dude.
I told Justin when you were in the bathroom, I said, Sal's going to be so
jack you.
Sal's going to be so excited to tell a story every time he tries to tell a story.
We're going to interrupt. Yeah. I figured that would happen.
Oh my god.
Go ahead, bro. I won't fuck with you.
That was fun. I got what I had to say out. So that was
my feelings are hurt now. Yeah. It's a very nice thing what I was gonna say.
Wow.
That was a very nice thing. Anyway,
you forgot.
You guys go.
Too bad.
No, it's like, when I left, I thought of like all the people I would miss, like my kids, you know, my family. And I missed you guys the most, more than anybody else. You know what I mean? Yeah.
I felt
my kids.
The same.
I actually missed work.
Yeah.
I think that's the first time probably in my life where, and I've had times before where in the middle of building a business or, you know, excited about something that's happening at work that, you know, I was thinking about it still when I was on vacation. But normally like I get into vacation and I'm enjoying myself and I'm not worried about home. And I wasn't worried at all about what's going on back here. But man, it was only a couple days in and I was already felt like, okay, I've rested plenty. I'm fully rested. Get me back to work. There's so many things that I want to work on and I want to do right now that it took a lot out of me to try and reset completely and detach from everything back here. How about you guys?
So I went to Kauai and the intention was not to go to a resort and just relax in the sun. I wasn't looking to do that. I wanted to go do some challenging hikes, some climbs, go see some stuff, really just kind of challenge myself and enjoy the natural beauty of the island. Which is what I did. And it was really only when I was doing those things that I was able to detach. Once I was back and just kind of relaxing, because we'd get back to the resort about like 3 p.m., then I was like thinking a lot about like what we can do, you know,
right.
Work-wise.
Business-wise.
I was missing.
Yeah.
But we went, we did Waimea Canyon, which they call the Grand Canyon of the Pacific. Hiked that. It did some challenging hikes there. The views were just spectacular. Then the next day, we did a hike on, what is that, Kalalau Trail, where you, which is, nobody told me this, it's fucking challenging, dude. Like,
oh, dude.
Like, you're going to die.
Yeah.
Like, if you fuck up,
you got to watch every single step. It's gnarly.
Yeah. You're going to die if you fuck up. Like, you're literally, I'm climbing.
On a cliff.
I'm going uphill, stepping on different rocks. It's wet because it rains there all the time. Some parts of the trail are about this narrow. So on the left of me is the mountain. On the right of me is you fall to your death.
Yeah.
Wow. So you're hiking that.
And no rails or no safety at all?
No. Nothing.
Wow.
And you cross several streams and there's no bridge or anything. Like you cross the stream. You have to like hop on rocks.
Yeah.
So we do this whole thing, not the whole trail, which is 11 miles. I wasn't going to do that because if you do the 11-mile trail, if you finish it, then you should camp at the end of it and then come back. There's no way you do the whole thing in one day. So all we did was like 5 or 6 miles, which took us like 3.5 hours. That's how challenging the trail was. It took us that long just to do that many miles.
Wow.
But we crossed these streams, and then finally at the very end, I'm like, oh, shit, we're almost there. This is awesome. Fucking stream was like full of water and I'm like, how are we gonna get across? Like, what are we gonna do?
Yeah.
I saw the video of Jessica falling down. Yeah. That was great.
My girl's like, we're just gonna walk through. And I'm like, I don't want to walk through fucking stream. Like, it's fucking running water. Like
walk through?
Yeah, I don't think I do that. But I did. I walked through and then there was a speech. But I'll tell you something. This is how big of a pussy I am with that kind of stuff, because I've never really challenged myself that way. Is there were kids on the trail too. Yeah. Like people were hiking with their kids and that would really give me like a gut check. Yeah. Like every time I was like, whoa.
Like, stop being a pussy.
Yeah, like I'm
a 7-year-old is getting through this.
Yeah, I'm scared. I don't know if I want to keep going. There's like a kid doing it. You know?
Skips right by you.
Oh, but it's such a gorgeous, just a beautiful island. I mean,
where did you guys stay?
We stayed at the Sheraton on Poipu Beach and we rented a car. So we would wake up every morning at like 6 a.m. and then we would be in the car 7 a.m. going to wherever we're going to go. And then we did luau's. I don't know if have you guys ever been to a luau?
I went there last time. Yeah.
We did the Smith family one, which is like this real traditional luau.
Okay.
Great performances, great food. I'm definitely going to go back and I'm going to go backpacking in Kauai next time. I'm going to do it like legit.
Did you do that one? Was it the inner tubing? Where you go through those rivers, like you go underneath?
No.
Like, yeah.
That's so much stuff to do.
All the plantation fields.
That's what I was asking him about if he did that.
That was a cool one.
You've got it booked at like months in advance now.
Really?
Oh, it's booked out for.
Oh shit.
Yeah, we looked into that when we were out in Maui. We were going to take a plane over there just to do that.
Yeah.
And why we didn't was we couldn't get in. It was a month before and we still couldn't get in.
So, oh, yeah, that was one of my favorite things I did there. That and the hiking, of course. Yeah. That was...
Well, there's this kayak thing that you can do that is along the North Shore or whatever, where you can kayak 3 days in a row to different campsites, and it's like hardcore. So I'm thinking about doing something like that next time, you know?
Rough it in Kauai.
Yeah, God.
That doesn't sound like my vacation at
but
all.
It's the lushness of the plants there. It's like so dense. You're like in a rainforest on the North Shore.
It is. Yeah.
Super, super dense. Tons of vegetation. Fruit growing everywhere. Chickens and pigs everywhere.
Yeah.
You could be...
Yeah, they ran all over the place.
Bro, you could like never have to buy food again. They allocate like one pig per person per day if you hunt them. And I don't know if you can hunt the chickens and kill them. I don't see why not. And then there's fruit growing everywhere. Like you could live there on the beach and eat like a king forever.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, you got everything you need.
Speaking of living there like that, we drove by, right? You'd say drive by. We floated by where, have you guys ever seen the show Alone? Are you familiar with that? Alone is this show where they drop off 10 contestants on this peninsula off of Alaska. So it's just north the border of Canada, and it's right at the bottom part of Alaska. And I forget the name of the island, but we drove right by there, and that's where they drop them off. And it's so the idea of this show. It's a reality show where they drop 10 contestants off. They're all like 15, 20 miles apart from each other, so they don't ever find each other. And the idea is who can survive the longest. And you get nothing. You get no food.
This is a really wet part of up there, like in Alaska.
I mean, honestly, everywhere is really wet up there.
Super wet.
Yeah, it's constant. I think they say like...
So wet. Every
day of winter is like rain. And then even in summer, it rains a lot. So it's pretty wet and cold. I mean, it was... I had packed accordingly, but still could have packed warmer and more clothes. I didn't realize how wet and cold that it really was. And I should have. I mean, we're going up to a fucking glacier and stuff. Right? Yeah. So, like, duh. But I, for some reason, I thought that, like, there would be other areas of Alaska that would be, like, warmer.
Did you see any grizzly bears or anything crazy?
We didn't see any grizzly bears up close. We saw some from far, but, I mean, it wasn't, like, same thing with the whales. Like, I saw some whales from far. I had one come up close to the boat. But a bunch of dolphins, and a bunch of bald eagles. So the wildlife was okay. I wanted it to, you know, I'd heard from other people like how amazing it was. And so one of the trips that we did because of weather got canceled. So the one I was most excited about, which is kind of a bummer, my first stop was in Juneau, Alaska. And we were to get in a helicopter and fly to a glacier, land on the glacier, and then go dog sledding.
Oh, shit.
And because the weather... was so fucked up, they actually canceled our trip. So I was really bummed about that because of all the things that we had set up.
Yeah, that sounds epic.
Yeah, because we set up, like we did ATV driving one day back in these old logging roads. We did, we hiked a couple different places that we were at to a glacier and a waterfall. And so every day we dropped into a port, we did something cool. But the one I was most excited about was the landing on the glacier.
How long would you guys stay in a port?
A day. So most of the ports you get in there like first thing in the morning. So you'd hit about 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock in the morning, and then you have basically all day till 10 o'clock at night to be on the whatever town it was. And most of these towns are, I mean, they are tiny. If it wasn't, they get cruise ships every single day for 6 months, and they have 4 to 5 cruise ships come in. Each cruise ship has like 3,000 people. So this town sees 15,000 people or so from the cruises every single day for 6 months of the year. Then the other 6 months, it's like a fucking ghost town. Like I talked to like a lot of the store owners, and they were telling me like you could literally light yourself on fire and run up down the street naked in 3 months, and there's nobody here. Like nobody would know you're on fire. Like there's just nobody around. But it was packed when I was there.
So when I travel, I like to notice or pay attention to the culture of the area. Did you notice anything about like the culture, like the people,
a little bit because it was hard. Because literally majority of what I saw was from the cruise.
Oh, yeah.
Like, so most people were very tourists, but it was neat because some of the tour guides and places that we were at would actually tell you like how to spot a local, like based off of how they were dressed. And so you know, most of the locals were always wearing like these tall rubber boots, which just gives you an idea of like what the weather probably looks like year round there. If like every day you put on a pair of, and they, I think they call them Alaska slippers. I think that was the, so Alaska slippers are these like fucking rain boots that go up to your knees because the weather is just so unpredictable there.
Yeah. So when I got back, I went on the freeway and I was driving like 55 miles an hour because I didn't realize I had acclimated to the speed that they drive on Kauai. Like everybody drives hella fucking slow.
So slow. Yeah.
It's like the most chill,
in,
relaxed.
In no hurry, right? Yeah. Everyone's flip flops and fucking, oh, come on in, come on in. Totally different than driving. I had the same shock when I got back here. And Katrina and I were talking about, because there, so talking about the cold right there, so you do notice that. You just, everybody is, when you live in California, the states period, but California, I think at most, like California, New York, I would think is like this too. The fast pace. Like
it's competitive as fuck.
Right, we are in such a hurry here to get places. And so when you go somewhere like Hawaii and Alaska, life is so different. Like the hustle and bustle to get from point A to point B is nowhere near what it's like for us here. So it's a bit of a culture shock when you're, and I have to like be patient, like, cause there's times where I catch myself getting irritated because, you know, people be in line like to buy something and they'd be having great conversation,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
and, yeah, like, yeah. And you're going like, motherfucker, like I'm standing here waiting in line, but I'm like, wow, this is just how everybody is. You know, you stop and you talk and you're friendly. And, you know, if I'm waiting in line, then I wait longer, you know what I'm saying? And, and just kind of how everybody is, like it's, there's no, there isn't this pressure to hurry up everywhere.
Yeah, I could totally see myself living in a place like that for a short period of time.
Oh, I was gonna say that
I could see it for a little while. I could see doing something insane like that, but then wanting to leave, you know, after like a
vacation,
couple years.
Yeah, I couldn't do it.
I don't really.
Yeah, it's just like it's too slow. I mean, I enjoy it to like as a change of pace, but I mean, I like to be challenged and I like to like be driven. So, you know, I need to be in that environment. I've thought of that too, like, you know, like staying even like 2 weeks for me is like too long, you know.
Oh,
like,
7 days was a lot. I was ready to get off the boat for sure. I mean, I'm on that boat too, so there's a difference there, I guess, a little bit, but just being away from it, I love that. I mean,
how was the food and stuff on your boat?
The boat food is fucking horrible. It's like cafeteria food, but I only ate that twice. So only two times that I actually, so you have the way that these cruises work, right, is you pay like this all-inclusive fee. So you have all the food is free on the boat. They have special areas, like it's fucking pizza and nuggets and like hamburgers and hot. Yeah. It's like fucking garbage food. It's horrible. Yeah. And then they have like cafeteria, like I mean, like a buffet style breakfast. Horrible. Everything's horrible. But then they have like these really fine dining, like, you know, 5-course, 6-course meal or restaurants throughout the boat, right? There's 5, I think. 5 on there. And they're all different. Like one was called the Salty Dog, and it was like American Grill, burgers, things like that were really good. And then there was another one that was like a crab shack, so it was all like crab legs and lobster, things like that, really good. Then we had another one that was kind of like a French style. There was duck and things like that served. So there's, but then you got to pay extra for that. So,
of course.
But, and for us, we were, and a lot of people I know, they go on these cruises and they're trying to save money. And so they, you know, you've paid for your all inclusive. So you could technically stay on that boat and not really spend any more money and just live off the food that they're giving you. But I can't, it was horrible. It got I tried the first day and I looked at Katrina. I couldn't even finish my plate. I'm like, no, fuck this. There's no way I can't do this. And so I literally lived off of our green juice. Like thank God that she brought some bars and then a box of our green juice from Organifi, and that became my staple breakfast. Like I woke up, I had a cup of coffee, and then I had my green juice, and that pretty much sustained me till we got to a port. And then we get to a port, I get off. Now the food on whenever we got somewhere, amazing.
Well, I'm sure the fish was probably.
Oh, my God. Yeah. The best crab. I had the best.
Caught like an hour ago.
Oh, bro, the best crab and lobster.
It's a different game, right?
Oh, it's a whole nother, like the best fish I've ever had here, which I think, I mean, we're close to San Francisco and the Bay.
Well, we've got good seafood. It's just different though.
Yeah, it's, it's another level of good there. That the halibut and the
yeah, see, because that's where they catch it all.
Yeah, the Alaskan cod, yeah, exactly. The halibut and the
king
and
crab,
the king. Yeah, and they have king crab here. So we normally eat, when you eat crab here, we normally eat Dungeness crab. Mm. King crab is there. So these crabs are this big. Legs, yeah, we had a leg. You know, I get a leg this big, literally a $40 leg. Like, so it's, $40 per leg. So we went to one place where you roll up and you order by the leg, and we'd all get all, we had to pile like $300 worth of legs. We were all digging it, but so good, dude. Mm-hmm. Oh, so good. So
were you able to get your hands on any vegetables over there? Because I would assume the vegetables probably would suck, right? Because they don't grow much up
very
there.
Tough to get vegetables. That's why I literally lived off our green juice. Yeah. I went through a full box of our green juice. Sometimes I had it twice in a day because of that exact reason. I pretty much what I would do was, I would eat as much seafood as I could when we hit the port. So I would eat a huge, huge meal, and then I would buy to bring back onto the boat for me to have later on again. So I would, you know, do that, and then in the morning time I was eating the or drinking the green juices, and that's pretty much how I survived through the trip. I got in two workouts in the gym. But the rest of the time, we were really
Oh, you worked out?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, actually.
I didn't do a single
Dude, thing. I worked out at the South Reno Athletic Club. Remember the one we went to?
Oh, yeah.
I went there twice, dude. Oh, love it was awesome. Place. Yeah, I showed my friends at gym. We powered it out. It was like, it's like a playground, dude, for, you know, it's got everything. We played basketball, you know, and then we like threw the ball around and shit on the grass.
That's
got
to be one of the best out. Gyms I've ever been at.
Yeah.
For sure. No, I didn't work out. We didn't work out at all. We did lots of hiking. But what we would do with nutrition-wise is our schedule would – we would go out real early, whether we were going to do a hike or whatever. We did ATV one day. Then when we'd get back at about 3, we would eat something, and then we'd have dinner. And the seafood in Hawaii is just incredible too. But it's all the local stuff that they catch. So you'll get the right. fish of the day. So – and then I ate fish tacos at some place that was supposed to be like one of the best. But it was this like little shack. Mm. But the fish tacos were fucking incredible.
That's how these – a lot of these places you get off – onto the port, and you go find the restaurants aren't really restaurants. Most of them are like these little trailers with a thing over, which that's how it's in Hawaii, like the same thing too. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are just these little trailers with a little canopy over the top of them, and they
some
are just
of those burger joints there.
Oh amazing. Man, they are just serving up some of the best. Now you, this was crazy to me because these towns in Alaska are super small. We didn't hit any of the big ones. We hit like a lot of the small Juneau. Ketchikan, Skagway. These are all like these really small, like only boat or plane. You can get to these places.
Dude, you ran into some mind pump listeners,
at every
right?
fucking place. This blew my mind.
That's crazy.
I was so surprised. You would think that we're a little used to it now when we go places, but not here. I'm thinking Alaska. Like, who the fuck is listening? I didn't even see a gym anywhere. Like, so I didn't even think it existed. And shout out to the guys over, and they were in, let's see here, Ketchikan, Skagway. We stopped there. They were the first ones that actually caught me before I got off the boat and messaged me and said, hey, come by our store, 907 Clothing in Skagway, and hooked it up. Just said, hey, pick anything you want. They're a huge fan of the show. I thought that was so awesome. Like, obviously, I bought something for Katrina, too. I couldn't just take something for free like that. It didn't feel right.
No, I got recognized at a luau. There was some kid there who comes up. He's like, oh, I listen to Mind Pump. And I was smashed.
Oh, you were?
Yeah, dude. They had – because at the luau, it included, like, drink as many of the Mai Tais as you want. And, I mean, Mai Tais, like, that's my kind of drink. You know what I mean? It tastes fucking sweet. You
the
know
fruitier,
what I'm
the better.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm just just pounding them, and I'm a lightweight anyway, so I'm hammered. And this kid comes up to me, and he's like, hey. And I'm like, oh, what's up, dude? Hey. What's Mind Pump? What are you guys talking about? Yeah. But, no, it was good. But I'm glad to be back, man. I missed you guys.
I know.
I had a great workout when I got back. I could tell my body felt good, needed some time off. So
I'm surprised
workout.
You didn't lift.
Not at all.
I'm proud of you.
Not even once.
That's tough for you, I think.
It used to be, not really anymore. I think if it was just a relax, like not do anything trip, then I probably would. But we did so much fucking hiking
activities.
And moving.
Yeah.
By the time I got back, man, I was just
That's
I was
how
tired
I felt.
And
I felt the same way, too.
Yeah. You a snorkeler? Did you do any of that?
I didn't do anything in the water.
What?
No, it was all in the mountains and hills and all that stuff. Mm. Yeah, but nothing else.
Doug, bring on the bird.
Vacation bird.
It's so lazy.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition,
Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from Prime and Glory. When we feel hunger, what is the difference between thinking you're hungry and your body actually needing something?
It's actually a good question.
It is.
And I think there's levels of needing something, right?
Yeah.
I think most people are their perception of like what our body needs and what it actually truly needs is really off.
I'll say a controversial statement, but I'll defend it. I think most people in, you know, Western developed nations probably have never really felt hunger. I don't think
like pushing the boundaries of hunger, right?
Yeah, we're like, oh, my
power bar, I'm gonna die.
Where your body actually needs it, right?
Yeah, I don't think we've ever really felt that. And here's another answer to this. Whether or not you think you feel hunger or you actually do, it doesn't matter. Both of them are perceived as, you know, feeling hungry. The difference is being able to separate if you're expecting to eat and if you actually need to eat. Because I know for myself, when I used to eat, you know, 6 or 7 small meals throughout the day, if I missed one of them, I'd be starving. I need to have food. I need to eat. I don't feel right. I'd feel lightheaded, or I used to think, I need to eat.
Low blood sugar and all that.
But the reality is I expected to eat and then I missed a meal that I expected to have.
Mm.
The first time I fasted, where I knew I was going to fast, and I'm like, okay, I know I'm not going to eat until tonight, I actually didn't feel anything at all. So I think a lot of it has to do with expectations. You know what I'm saying? I could go to a movie and, you know, sit in a movie theater and crave and think I want popcorn, but there's that association that's going on.
You've conditioned yourself, you know, and so like you said, your expectation for eating is really like, that's like what you're feeling. Like you're more than not, like I doubt that you've been away from food long enough to really experience what hunger is.
We're so disconnected from the actual signals that our body sends us that we think we're hungry when we're not. We may just be thirsty. Mm-hmm. We may just be bored.
Just have a craving.
If I'm at home and I have nothing to do, which rarely ever happens, but let's say I have a day off and I'm at home, I'll eat more just because I have nothing else to do. I'm kind of bored and I recognize that. So it's a good question, but I'll tell you this.
Well, we also have to define what need means.
Yeah.
Because do we mean our body actually needs it because we've ran out of glucose? Mm-hmm. Is that what we mean by need? And so we're now, but we know what happens when that happens, yeah. Right? When we tap out of that, our body now starts to use ketones and fat as a source for fuel, which that's not a bad thing whatsoever. And in fact, we should probably be trying to put ourselves in that position more often than not. So, you know, what do we mean by need? Now, if you're somebody who has a goal of bulking and building muscle, and that's your primary goal, well, and you completely deplete and you become catabolic, it's not advantageous for somebody who's trying to build muscle. So that person, you know, those signs of hunger is probably a good sign to tell you that, hey, you need some more fuel or more food because you're probably running low. But that's because your goal is to build and you want to be in a surplus more often than not. But if you're the average person who's looking for health or is trying to lose body fat, I mean, we're probably trying to flirt with this feeling of hunger more times than not.
Yeah, you are. And, you know, real physical hunger doesn't come on suddenly. It's kind of a gradual build. And so the reason why I'm explaining this is because a lot of times you'll eat breakfast or you'll eat lunch and then a few hours later, like, oh my God, I'm starving. That's not real hunger. That's probably more of an emotional type of hunger, where emotional hunger comes on very sudden. It's more of a craving. You can also ask yourself this question, you know, oh my God, I'm so hungry. I'm starving. I want to eat this, you know, burger. I want to eat this whatever. Would you have that same feeling if I put a bunch of carrots or celery in front of you, or something that's not necessarily palatable? If you still feel that feeling, then you know that it's real hunger and not just, you know, a craving for something. Because we've all been in that situation where we just ate a meal, someone put something sweet in front of us, and now we feel like, oh, I'm hungry for that ice cream, or I'm hungry for that dessert. which is, again, more of that emotional connection. I recommend this. If you're healthy and, you know, you get cleared by your doctor and everything's okay, I would say go on a prolonged fast. That will reset how you connect to some of these signals big time. Like if you could do like a good 24 to 48 hour fast, then you can start to really identify what real hunger is and what just cravings are.
Well, that was so eye-opening for me, like, because even just getting into workouts and not fueling myself before workouts, like I had to literally go through a 24 hour fast to understand that, you know, like I can power through this and I'm going to be fine. You know, just to experience, just to step out of like your ritual that you're so hardwired in the way that you eat for so long. It's like your body expects, you know, okay, well, I expect a meal here and I expect a meal here. And it's to interrupt that, it's really liberating.
Yeah.
Well, I think a lot of where this question stems from too is the old myth of, you know, if I'm starving like this, will my body start to metabolize muscle and will that start falling off my body, right? Mm-hmm. Like, because even if this person wants to lean out, they probably want to lean out but hold on to as much lean body mass as they possibly can. And quite frankly, if you're hungry and you're not pushing and exercising or doing any strenuous exercise, your body is not going to utilize muscle to get you through the rest of the day. Not at all. Especially if you're not.
It takes a while before that happens.
Not only does it take a while, but then it also takes you pushing the body, right? Because you're not really doing anything for it to want to utilize. It's just muscle is an expensive tissue. It's not a place it wants to go. I think an old school myth is that, you know, oh, if you, you know, don't eat and the body goes into starvation mode and then it starts to eat away at your muscle. I mean, I remember giving that terrible advice because I thought that's how it worked, and it's not how it works at all.
And then you sold them bars.
Yeah, no, exactly, right? And then you would tell them, hey, when you start to get hungry, have a small snack or a bar to make sure that doesn't happen. Well, that's all a bunch of bullshit. And honestly, there's more health benefits from you probably finding this place of hunger every once in a while, pushing through that, and then realizing like, oh, it wasn't that bad for me to do that, which is why we advocate fasting intermittently.
I was just going to say, I mean, for the most part, humans forever, for almost all the time we've been on Earth, because it's a very short period of time that we've been on Earth, we've had all this food available to us. We went, on average, we would go, you know, a day, 2 days, 3 days, a week, 2 weeks without food all the time. People who are born in modern times, who live in these, you know, modern wealthy societies, probably have never gone longer than 24 hours without food. And if they did, it was because they were sick or something like that. Like most people, if you go up to someone, you ask them, hey, have you ever gone 72 hours without food? They'll say no. Most people, no one's ever experienced that. I remember the first time I did a prolonged fast, I felt hungry initially, but it wasn't real hunger. Looking back, it was more like, oh my God, I need to eat. Mm-hmm. Once I got past that, I'm not gonna lie. I didn't have hunger. Like after 48 hours, I'm like, whoa, I feel like I could go another 48 hours. Mm-hmm. And I made myself eat because I had only planned on doing, you know, a 72 hour fast. But I felt like I could go much longer. I didn't experience this like starving feeling at all.
Yeah.
The other thing you want to consider too is you may be associating the feeling of being stuffed with being satisfied. And what I mean by that is, I can't tell you how many times I would have a client eat, or even I experienced this myself, where you'd eat a meal and be like, ooh, I'm not full yet. I think I need to eat more food. Mm-hmm. And the problem with that is that I had associated this stuffed feeling with being satisfied. Like at the end of my meal,
That's been one of the hardest things for me to break to this day. I still catch myself. That's a hard habit to break. Mm. And I think more people than we realize have this same issue, and they don't even realize it, is we tend to do this, is where we eat until you feel that, like, your body telling you, like, okay, that's too much.
It's okay, like, that's enough, yeah.
Learning for me to manage my portion controls, this is also, again, and I know that, you know, there's two sides to this, right, where we talk about weighing and measuring food and portion control, that people can get crazy with that, and that can become unhealthy also. But it did teach me a lot about what I actually, my body actually needed and what I should be consuming versus my old way of consuming food, which is eat until my body says, okay, that's enough. And like finishing your plate when I probably could have ate 3 ounces less of that, 2 ounces less of that. And that ended up adding up to be 400 or 500 extra calories.
Yeah, it's interesting, like being overfed, like the same thing. I've struggled with that, like to where you want to feed yourself to where you feel like, okay, I'm full, like I've eaten all that. And then, you know, carrying that around, like I've just, you know, recently the last 2-3 years realized that, like, okay, if I've eaten a substantial meal, like I don't even need to eat the next meal even. Like, yeah. There's parts where like I understand when I'm oversaturated, like that's really where the problems start to come out with the heartburn and with like the
right,
all this extra stuff that's going on with my body trying to process this. It's like stressing it out, you know, internally. And so like just messing with that alone has really helped.
How many times has someone said to you when you're eating over their house or whatever, like, do you still have any room? Do you still want to, you know, can you eat more? Would you like some more? And you think to yourself, like, I think I can fit a little more in.
Do that. Yeah.
Like, it's a thing. Like, you need to stuff yourself.
Do you know something that's helped me out with that? And we recently discussed this. Remember when you and I got into the whole water debate on here, right? And again, I'm always one who likes to, you know, push myself out of my comfort zone or challenge my own way of thinking, this and that. And so, you know, something I've never really tried to do is eat my meals with no fluid.
Mm.
And man, it really forces you to chew the fuck out of each bite. It
makes a big difference.
Yeah, you cannot just shovel the food down, because that the only way I could do that, and I realize this now, because of course I've had some days where I go back to having fluid with it, mm-hmm. but I've done it enough now to be very aware of the difference. And there's a major difference when I've got a drink and I'm eating. It's crazy. You just have this habit of you take a couple bites and then you end up, you find yourself washing it down.
Bro, you're taking it like pills. Like you're literally biting it into like something you could swallow with water. Like you're taking it like supplements with your food. When in reality, you're liquefying it, which is what you're supposed to do. That is a big part of digestion is in your mouth when you're chewing your food. And so if you don't fully chew your food, You're cutting out a big part of digestion.
And I challenge somebody to overconsume without water or something to wash it, some sort of a fluid to wash it. It's fucking hard. It's amazing how hard it's been. I find myself like, fuck, I don't want to eat anymore. My mouth is so dry. I want some fluid. I'm like,
I'm gonna choke all the time, dude.
Yeah,
that's a big problem. Just eating it big and fast.
And that's a part of this whole what I keep talking about, where the signals have been we have skewed and fucked up our signals so much that we don't even know how to read them. Like, that's one of them. One of them is, if you're eating food without water readily handy right next to you or soda or whatever, and you having to chew the hell out of it like you're supposed to and then swallow it so that you don't choke or whatever, like that is also helping your body's signals be more accurate as well, because it's going to tell you, okay, you've eaten enough. You know, you don't need to eat more.
It's like,
but if you're washing it down,
everything better. Yeah.
Dude, when I used to stuff my face, that's why I learned to eat that way, by the way. I learned to eat with a big glass of water next to me.
Me too. Yeah, because you had to shovel it down.
Because I was always trying to gain weight. Yeah. And it was literally like, I could eat way more. I can eat, you know, 12 ounces of dry chicken breast if I just wash it down with water than if I sit here and have to chew on it. And so, again, that's just one of those signals. So, yeah, I would say slow down, try fasting. Start to really become in tune with your body. Eat until you're about 50 to 60% full with your meal. Think of it that way. I had to do that for a little while, to where I ate and I said, okay, I'm about 60% full. I'm going to stop eating. And then you start to become more connected to these signals, and it becomes easier to know when you're actually hungry versus when you're just having an emotional, you know, when you're emotionally hungry, which is something totally different.
Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code Mind Pump for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite, put in the code Mind Pump and get 10% off. Go check it out.
All right, our next question is from Eat, Sweat, Sleep, and Repeat. Advice for long-distance relationships.
Oh, wow.
We got to summon the wizard.
Fuck.
Welcome back the wizard.
Here you go. You ready for it? Don't have them.
Yeah. Waste of time.
Man, I tell you what. I feel like my advice on this probably has changed over time, like what I would think. I had my first like high school sweetheart. She went off to Cal Poly while I stayed back home and went to junior college. So for about a year and a half there, we were in a long distance relationship, and a lot of gas money went to driving down there on weekends and speeding tickets of getting there. It was about a 3.5-4 hour drive.
God, so it was the same thing. It's crazy,
right? And it wasn't like super long distance. That's, I mean, long enough to where we don't see each other every night, and I'd be driving down there every weekend that I could. That was probably one of the most stressful relationships I've ever been in my life, for sure. Most challenging on so many levels. Now, mind you, I was only about 20 years old, I think, around that time. 20, 21, somewhere around there. Maybe even a little bit younger, 19, actually. And I think that I would have totally handled that differently. She was a beautiful girl going to off to college in a sorority, and I was, you know, hanging on to her and wanting to keep her as close as possible. And she was probably going through that phase in her life where she was wanting to spread her wings a bit in freedom, and she was moved out from her
spread
parents.
Those wings.
Right, for first, you would go there.
Sorry,
maybe a little bit.
And
of
you
that
and you guys weren't having sex either, right?
Yeah, no, I was a virgin at this time.
Oh,
still,
fuck!
So, yeah.
So she went away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
To college, hot
it's
girl.
Like, whoa, all this attention.
Not having sex.
Yeah. Yes.
That was a
Oh, I mean, I have stories of us being on
an
a phone,
awakening.
Being on the phone on like a Thursday night at like midnight, you know, talking. Back when you remember when you're that old, you talked on the phone with your girlfriend for like an hour. Like, you can't get me on the phone, period, much less for fucking 5 minutes, much less an hour.
I know, you think about all this. What did you talk about?
That's just stupid,
nonsense.
Right? Stupid. So, I mean, talking on the phone for an hour or whatever like that. And, you know, you'd be like midnight, and she lived in the dorms the first year. So
what do they do now? Is it like FaceTime? Is that what the kids do?
Probably. Yeah. Snatch.
So removed.
Snatch chat.
Yeah. Snatch chat.
Yeah. So,
okay.
So we'd be on the phone, and like somebody would, dudes would bust through her door, and you'd hear them like jump on her bed, tickling her and stuff. I'm
like, get the fuck out of here.
Swear to God, dude. Swear to God.
Oh, no, dude.
Swear to God. So, imagine
who
I'm
Karen, I'll see you at the Kegger.
Yeah. Literally just like that. Then I'd be on the phone, you know, whispering. They're like, "Oh, I miss you so much.
I got some jello shots.
I can't wait
for
to
you.
See you.
Hang up with your dorky
boom,
boyfriend."
You hear this, and phone drops. You're giggling and shit like that.
I'm
sitting on the other side waiting.
She's
for
like,
a few
Mark, minutes. Stop tickling.
Oh,
me.
Totally, oh totally God. Like that, bro. And then she gets back on the phone. I'm like, what was that?
Who's that? Who the fuck was that guy?
Oh, that's just Steven and Richard from down the hall. And
he's my study buddy.
Yeah, right. Yeah, totally.
Whatever.
Totally that stuff, man. And so I was just like pulling my hair out as a kid. You know, it's probably why I'm losing my hair now, right? It's all
I had the same exact shit.
So, you know,
funny.
All this stuff, I mean, obviously, you know, it grew me into the
How'd
man.
You guys break up? Did she end up cheating on you or something?
Kind of like that. So the short version I'll give you is, obviously, we had, that was just one small example of what I was going through all the time, right? And it finally got to the point where she obviously wanted to move on, but then we had so much history together, she didn't have like the guts to like break it completely off. And I should have been I'm a young man, not smart, the older, wiser.
Well, you're in love, dude.
Right. So yeah, exactly. So I don't want to let go. And I remember her coming back one time to visit me, and we went to dinner. And I think I've told you guys this story. I don't know if I shared this on Mind Pump before, but she left me that night to go to her friend's house, and she was like, "I'll call you later, and we'll meet up." You know, that was back in the days too, when you're like, you know, you got to sneak around to see your girlfriend and shit like that, so you could fool around in the car or some shit. So, you know, she's like, "I'll call you when I get to my girlfriend's house and spend the night there." Well, I fell asleep with the phone to my ear, never heard from her, or my pager back then. I think is what we had. And
I feel so bad for you, dude.
At like 2 o'clock in the morning. No, it's okay. This is a totally good story. So at 2 o'clock in the morning, the phone rings, and I answer it, and it's her mom, and her mom's like, "Hey, where's Emily?" And I'm like, "I don't know." And she's
and you're a good kid, so you're like, "She's hurt, I need to find
well,
her."
Well, so I go well, you know, she went to Kyra's house. And she's like, "Well, no, I called Kyra, she's not there." And so then I freak out. I'm like, "Oh my God, well, that's where she was supposed to be. She's not there. So I tell her mom, like, I'm coming over now. So I get in the car, I race over, I go pick her mom up. And then at that moment, it dawns on me that I knew there was like an upperclassman party that was in town. And I'm like, and I knew like she was like the hot girl in school. So all the older guys liked her and shit. So that was something I dealt with even too back then when we were in school. Like all the college guys liked her when she was still in high school. And now there was this party in town. And I'm like, fuck, I bet you she's over there. So we roll up there. Sure as shit, her car is there. And only her car is there. Nobody else's. Lights are all out in the house.
Oh, no.
And so I like let her mom out and I followed her mom.
Are you here for the gangbang?
Yeah, totally, dude. And so her mom, she bangs on the door forever. Mom trying to wait. Finally, she calls her mom and her mom goes back and picks her up or whatever and takes her home. And that was pretty much the end of our relationship because then after that, we fucking broke up, of course, right? So it was...
Do you still see...
I was so drunk and he was so nice to let me in and just sleep.
And those guys were so nice.
Yeah.
Did you see... do you know what she looks like now?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I'm still attached to her. I see her on my Instagram.
Does she look good still or is she fat now?
Well, she's...
I'm trying to...
This is important.
Yeah, we need like... I want to feel good right now. Like,
she's pretty. She's always been into working out, so she's kept herself in pretty good shape. She's also on kid number 3, I believe, right now. So she's been... The guy who she, after we broke up, she got with this guy and was with the same guy ever since then. They've been together forever and now have 3 kids. And I remained in contact with her for many years afterwards. We still, even though that was a bad breakup, we still stayed, you know, somewhat friends. Like
Cal Poly, man. Once they go there, it's over.
Long distance thing, honestly, and I don't know.
I feel like there's pluses and minuses
to it,
right?
I think it really depends on where you're at in your life and with this relationship. Because if you're somebody who, like, looking back now, that was the stupidest thing I could have ever done. As a young kid, you should be wise. You're not wise enough then, but I should have been talking to my younger self. I would have told myself, like, let her go. You know, let her go. If you really love her, and I know it's cliche to say this, but they say, you know, if you love something, set it free, and if it returns, it's meant to be, right? I really believe that. I believe that. People really kill relationships by hanging on to things.
Totally.
Like, if you really love each other, like, distance isn't going to stop that, your guys' connection to each other. What is going to happen, though, is the stress of not seeing each other, where are you at last night, who were you with, all that stuff takes an incredible relationship and it destroys it because of all the insecurities that, and when really, when you have to learn to look at yourself when you have these situations, like, you know, I'm sure the guy is coming in and tickling her on the phone. You know, everybody's like, oh, you know, we could blame her all day, but, you know, shame on me. Who cares? She's in college. Yeah. Like, she's a freshman in college. Like, why would I ever want to get in the way of her having the most amazing experience? And if that means letting guys come in your room at midnight and tickle you, then fucking who am I to say otherwise? Like, and how's that have an effect on our love?
But then that, you reflecting on that, though, I had the same experience and it was like, I actually decided, no, I'm just going to leave, you know, and I got to figure myself out. And, you know, and that was the best thing ever because, like, that relationship was the same thing. I was, like, holding on to it so hard, you know, like, oh, this is, like, my comfort space,
right?
You know? And it's, like, once you get away from that, every relationship since was, like, you know, I just had this peace about it. Like, you can do your thing. You be with me if you want, you know, like,
right.
or not, you know? Like, let's establish that right away and, like, have communication with
it. Yeah, I feel like there's pluses and minuses, right? Like, I think the minus is like what you guys are talking about. And then the pluses, maybe if you're older, you know, both people have jobs and mature. I don't know. I feel like there may be some positives to it as well, because it could allow you the time to be super independent at the same time. You know what I'm saying? If you were to do it, I'm trying to look at the positives.
Well, I have one client who is 50. She's, oh my God, I don't want to fuck up her age. We're just going to say she's 50 because I don't want to go too
49.
High. Right, yeah. She's 49. Yeah. I have 2 clients in their late 40s, early 50s that both are in a long-distance relationship. Not really long. The guy lives over in Oakland and the other one lives over in San Francisco and they both live here. And they've been together for like 7 years and they don't see each other during the week. They see each other on the weekends. Now, they are extremely independent women. One of them owns 9 McDonald's. The other one is successful in real estate, flies and travels all over the place.
See, that's where I could see.
So like they have, and we talk about it all the time. I always ask them, like, you know, if they, oh, do you guys wish you see it? You're like, you know what? Honestly, we've done these days where we're together during the week. And I could totally relate to this because I'm very much so this guy. She's like, you know what? When we're together on a weekday, he's so consumed by work that I'm not getting any one-on-one attention from him anyways. And I'm doing my thing anyway. So it's like, it's not that big of a deal. And then when we get to see each other, we miss each other so much from the week that we spend all the time with each other and we're
not
distracted.
That's what I'm saying. I feel like you could have, if you do it right and you're mature enough, and that's what I mean by that. Like I could never do this as a kid. I could never do this as a young kid.
Yeah, you definitely have to be mature.
Way too many insecurities.
Yeah. Now, obviously, now with my girl now, it'd be difficult because we live together. But let's just say, you know, I was single. I got my kids. We got the business. I could see how there could be some benefits, right? Because you could focus on you could be independent, and then, like you said, on the weekends, now you get to have your time.
Well, right. Katrina would be a great one to talk to because I'm actually her first boyfriend that has ever been local. For 30 something years, she has always dated men.
She's very business and motivated.
Right. Yeah. Out of state or at least out of city where she's that's how she's always dated guys. She's never wanted to be around somebody that often where she's like, and that was for those reasons. They would always just be in her business. She's too independent to have somebody in her shit all the time. And she really enjoyed the long distance relationships until I came along. So before that, I think there can be great stuff to long distance. To me, it depends on your age, depends on where you're at with that current relationship. I think there's a lot to be said about having the confidence of not allowing the distance to cause all the stuff that it's inevitable will come. Like you'll have to
be pretty secure.
Yes, you're going to have moments of insecurity. I don't care how old you are. There will be moments where because you're so far away from each other, you know, where were you at last night? Why didn't you call me back of this? Or, you know, I feel like you don't want to come see me because you've been so busy with work and what's going on and who's the new guy that you're working with now. Like, I mean, there's so many things that are going to happen. And if you find yourself, you know, becoming this jealous guy or girl because of all these situations, to me, that's where this long distance relationship becomes unhealthy. Mm-hmm. And at that point, if you really love this person, you're probably better off stepping away from it because really, if you're that connected, you love each other that much, if you move away from each other and allow each other to go their separate ways, you'll eventually find each other again. I guarantee it. It's just most people don't have the cojones to do that to where they're too insecure. They're too afraid that if you walked away from this, you're going to lose it forever. Mm-hmm. And if you're in that kind of a relationship, it's probably
not good.
You're not in a healthy situation that's how you feel anyway. So that's my shitty advice there.
Experts at
just go for it. Love
everything.
Bet on love. Next up is Ashley Farias. Do you think it is legitimate that to be great at a sport, you need to start at a young age?
What do you mean by great? Like a professional level?
That must be. Yeah, must be talking about specialization.
Definitely no, because there is tons of stories. Michael Jordan.
When did he start playing basketball?
Not till high school, dude.
Yeah.
Well, that's still.
And he wasn't even good.
That is not, bro. Young. When people say young, okay,
they're talking about like
five, 6 years old. Yeah, yeah. Tiger Woods was playing golf at 3.
Well, there's this
bro.
Epidemic of parents getting fucking crazy with this. Right. And there's like specializing.
There's a
trophy kids.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Mark Bell and Chris Bell and him did one called Trophy Kids. Mm-hmm. Great documentary on this exact getting extreme, like going way overboard because parents turn into these trying to live vicariously through their kid. Yeah. It's like how it's the same that you see with those pageants, you know, the moms with the pageant girls, how unhealthy that can become. It can become unhealthy when parents start to put their kids in sports because they want them to be successful versus the kid really wanting to.
And then it gets weird because it's like your identity, you know, through your kids, it's like, you know, whatever they did, like it should amount to what you did, you know, and your experience like with the sports and all that kind of stuff. So this has been one of those things for me, like I always think about because I'm totally like, I can identify like those signs like way ahead of time, like, oh my God, I'm getting into this. I want like this for them and I want them to experience it the way I did and like this. And so I've been very cautious to like embed myself into their process with this versus like really observe and then, you know, interject myself where I feel you know, they're looking for advice. They're looking for help. They're looking to play catch with me. You know, they're seeking these things from me, and it's just starting to happen.
Yeah,
so.
You know, I think the reason why this happens is I think people or parents believe that this plays a bigger role in their child being great at a sport than it actually does.
It will. Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
So yeah. It'll. Here's where it will matter. Okay?
It's there. It's not.
So if you have a 7-year-old kid and you get him in him or her into their sport right away, right? And you're getting. So my uncle's an example of this. Like, so he's had my cousins, you know, training with the quarterbacks who fucking trained Steve Young, and like he was paying out all this money to have like the best of the best coaches around them. They were in all the leagues year round. And, you know, one of them ended up playing just through high school. The other one went off to college, went off to a D1 school and played all 4 years in college, and then nothing after that. Now, I think that getting them involved at that young age helped them excel at the at like youth football, right? Mm-hmm. But genetically, nothing that my uncle could do was going to take my cousin to the professional level of football.
Mm-hmm.
And there's that's where you, when you get to the, when you talk about pros.
People don't understand what those levels mean.
Right. Not only do you have to have the work ethic, not only did you start probably years before, but you also have the genetics. Like you have, then this is where the genetic component comes in so much. And I talk about this a lot. I throw out the whole swimming thing with me, right? Like I've never been taught or trained how to swim properly, but yet I have this gift to get in a pool and I can swim pretty damn well for someone who doesn't know how to do it. And so had I been trained at an early age, I probably could be at a higher level. Now, I probably could never have got to the Olympic level or crazy because maybe I just don't have it genetically there. Maybe I have a little bit more of a genetic advantage than Justin or Sal at swimming in a pool, but not quite enough to be Michael Phelps status, right? Sure. So, you know, they both play a role. But when you talk about getting a kid into that, you're trying to hope that one day they play a pro, genetics are going to play the largest role.
Yep. And you know what you find more often than not? When people, parents put their kids in sports with the idea that my kid's going to be a great football player one day or a great baseball player one day, is more often than not, you see kids who grow up to hate what they used to do.
Absolutely.
I know. I had clients like this. I had clients who their parents put them in swimming or gymnastics or something else at an early age, and it was like this, we're going to make you great type of thing. And once these kids grew up and graduated from, you know, high school or college, they never wanted to fucking step foot in it again. I have a friend.
Well, not only that, it takes over their identity.
That's what I'm saying. I have a friend who competed in synchronized swimming at a very high level. In fact, she was an Olympic alternate, okay? She now has daughters, and her daughters take to the water like fish, and she's like, fuck, man, I hope they don't want to do. She hates it so much, and she hopes her kids don't want to do synchronized swimming because she was forced to do it so much as a kid, and that's what you see more often than not. Now, you got to also look at the payback or whatever potential dividends you may get. Let's say you take your kids and you put them in sports at a young age, and you're thinking you're going to make them great. The odds of them getting a lot of benefit from that are actually pretty small. They're definitely going to get good at their sport, better than most kids because they're at a young age. The odds of them actually making a living of doing it are still tiny. Now, if you took that same effort and had your kids learn something like other language, whatever.
It's a good point.
Again, they may not be, you know, a Steve Jobs or some tech wizard, but they're going to get a lot more out of it.
We could debate this a little bit because but then again, you're putting them in academics, so then I think that's a very good recommendation, right? Because there's all kinds of stats to show kids that play sports.
Yeah. Oh, those benefit for sure. Yeah.
They get higher grades. They
stay out of trouble.
Yeah, they stay out of trouble. Yeah. They're less likely to do drugs. There's all these great stats to show how positive
it
is.
Well, with other people.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Sure. Right. There's lots of great benefits to starting a kid in sports at a very young age. I think just as a parent, you have to have a healthy relationship with that and them, and understanding that. Like, so I think that I wish my parents got me. I didn't start basketball until I think I was in 7th or 8th grade. I wish I was playing at 5. Because I think I would have been a better high school player had I done that. Now, do I think that would have taken me to the collegiate level or even pros? Definitely not. Just because I don't have it. I could have been that much better in high school, but I don't think I would have been better enough to go to the elite level. So you're really helping your kid out with that. Like, he's probably going to be better at the high school level, maybe college level, because you started him at a very early age, or her at a very early age, but the likelihood of you making the difference of them going pro or they got it or they don't got it.
I think too, like, I mean, there's an argument too for, you know, as you specialize like completely, like how you're just destined for all these imbalances, like even like earlier onset.
Oh my God, you're right.
So, you know, versus,
well, we talked about this with Kelly Starr,
that's
right?
What I was going to bring up. Yeah, he was even mentioning like what coaches are now seeking, you know, like more players that have more of a diverse background with like different sports and unique skills, because, you know, all that stuff helps to provide, you know, the joints will move better and operate more efficiently longer term. So, like, you know, like careers are very short lived for people that specialized.
You know what? So my uncle, who I keep referring to, also coaches Little League football, and I used to love to go watch him coach these little guys, and he would coach 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. And, you know, at that level, he used to just whoop the shit out of all the other coaches too. And my uncle just loves, he's super competitive. And, you know, his magic, he would say, is really in the simplicity. He says, you know, I teach these kids all season long 3 to 4 fucking plays. Mm-hmm. And they know those.
So De La Salle sort of method.
Totally. Yeah. And he's a huge fan of De La Salle. And he drills this home, and then it is. It's like, and I remember I'd come, like I just watched last year, and I came and watched his season, and he always points out like who the kids are. You know, he's like, watch 17, watch 5, watch 3, and they're just gonna run the same play. And then you see these kids that, you know, they're not doing anything like super smart on the field, like knowing the field really well. It's just they're athletically gifted. They're just, mm-hmm. they're a step faster than every other child. And he can put them at quarterback. He can put them at running back. He can put them at cornerback. He can put them at safety. He can put them in any position in the field, and they separate mm-hmm. themselves. And that's not because
it's
those kids.
Like, it's mindless. Yeah.
Yeah. They have a step on everybody. Mm-hmm. And that's the genetic component.
As a coach, you can argue at that level, at the high school level, that's going to win you the most games, right? Because,
right.
you know, like, and that's what I experienced too, going from high school and then to college. It's like, you know, I only had to know like basically maybe like 4 or 5 people's positions on the field, what they're responsible for, and like, you know, the zones and all that kind of stuff, and like what was happening in the play. Versus college, you have to know every single person, what everybody's doing. Every single play. And then like everybody in the huddle, we have to know what everybody's doing, so that way everything runs efficiently. And mm-hmm. it's like way more complex, way more film to break down, way more, like, it's so much more sophisticated. But you know, there's something to that simplicity, you know, in that level it works.
So I feel like when you say something like that, what goes through my head in answering a question like this, I think, so if you have a kid who naturally takes to a sport and they love it, I think the best thing that you can do is to encourage the repetitions and the practice and the running the plays, and like that's probably what's going to get them to excel or be better than anything else. If they've got the talent, they have the gift, and they love to do it, mm-hmm. is to then guiding them in the direction. Trying to force a kid into a sport because you want them to be good at that sport, or you think that they could be good at that sport, and in reality it's not a matter of you getting them started a year or two earlier. It's really them finding what their thing that they love, their thing that they're passionate about, they enjoy, and they have some talent, which for kids, it's normally the thing they're good at, right?
Like, shit, if they want to do it, yeah, like, help them out with that and let them, like, sharpen their skill with that.
Right,
there's nothing wrong with that. But, yeah, just, like, make sure that they're getting, you know, exposure to all these different things.
It's a balancing act as a parent. You have to balance, like, when you kind of push and when you don't. Because there's definitely times when, you know, you have to set structures, and you have to, you know, there's definitely times when you tell your kid no, when you tell them, yes, you got to do this, and, you know, I'm going to push you a little bit. But yeah. I think I've seen a lot of parents like this where they go, I've trained these kids. I've trained kids whose parents were like this. And I kind of cringe sometimes because I'd see these kids. I'm like, this kid is not happy mm-hmm. being forced to do these things. They may be good. They may be doing it.
It's not going to last.
It's not going to last. They don't like it. They're developing a poor relationship with this sport, or with, you know, this, you know, being forced to do this. And the second they have the freedom to say no when they become an adult, that's the first thing they're going to run away from. And so, you know, you kind of got to be careful with a little bit. But as far as starting at a real young age, you know, someone like Tiger Woods, who started so young, whose dad coached him, he also fucking wanted to do it. Like, he loved it.
Yeah.
Serena Williams and her sister, you know, same thing.
He's also a bit of a degenerate now, too.
So. That's true. That's true. That's a good point. That's a very, very good point. Yeah. You know?
Yeah, it's interesting. I just remember, like, a statistic. Somebody's telling me, like, the, like, lacrosse, like, how that sport just blew up here in the States because parents didn't know the game. They didn't understand it. So guess what? They can't fucking coach their kids how to do it. And their kids loved it. And that was interesting.
And they just had fun doing
it. Yeah, they just had fun.
I have a friend, this is a sad story, and this is kind of related to the question, whose parents were extremely strict and rigid. Both parents, advanced degrees, very intelligent. He was a smart kid too. I mean, the kid always got straight A's, hardworking kid, but his parents were always on him, pushing him harder and harder to perform academically. And he was valedictorian, got to a, you know, private college, you know, great SAT scores, you know, ended up getting a PhD, got a job, got laid off, was unemployed for 4 months trying to find work, and killed himself, committed suicide, actually wrote a suicide note and blamed it all on, and I felt so bad for his parents, but blamed it all on the environment that he grew up in, where he could not go out as a kid. He couldn't do anything. He would get straight A's. It still wasn't good enough. They pushed him and pushed him and pushed him, and he did perform at an extremely high level, but it cracked him. He broke. And I know that's an extreme example of that, but it was very, very sad. I remember hearing all this, and it was just like, oh, man, I felt so bad for his parents who have to now live with the fact
that now no fucking parents.
Horrible. Holy shit.
Well, okay, son, we're not signing you up for Pop Warner this year. Fucking Sal just says you're going to kill yourself.
It just reminded me of this conversation. But it was,
we need to depress everybody. Sorry. Moving along, Doug.
Yeah. Damn it.
Hey, kids, play video games all day. I just heard Sal tell a story.
Get in there and read.
Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audio book. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Next up is Shrelly W. How do you guys deal with performance anxiety?
Like what? in the bedroom?
Yeah, like
I don't know.
I yell at it. I'm like, you perform,
or maybe
you
they
can do it.
Maybe they mean by like the show, like getting in front of camera, doing all that.
Any performance, all performance anxiety, I think, is the same, right? It's all anxiety over your own expectations of what you think you need to do or whatever you think other people think.
Okay,
you should be able to do.
Okay,
right?
You can draw. Yeah, I know. I'm having the visual of like looking down at your dick, talking to it right now, like freaking out, like, oh my god, come on,
man.
Yeah.
One, two, three.
Yeah, why
go.
Aren't you working? Yeah. So this is different from person to person. For me,
well, yeah, let's go around here. I mean, I was joking about the. I don't think anybody in here has performance anxiety in the bedroom. But I'm sure we've all experienced, maybe not. Yeah, exactly. If you are, go ahead and share. But maybe I'm sure we've all gone through this. I know we've kind of talked off air before about what it was like the first time that we stood up in front of a audience of people and talked, the first time we got on these microphones, first time we had to do YouTube, there was some of this performance anxiety. I think I don't you could classify.
We started out by drinking a lot to deal with it.
Right. We did.
That's our answer.
That was it.
No, it was. And you know what's funny is I remember feeling that we had to do that to settle down. And I really feel like that it's the numbing part of that, right? You're trying to settle the mind down, and so you're trying to numb it, whether it be through cannabis or having a couple of drinks, whatever. That's what we used to do before our show, before we got on the mics. But then it got to a point where we had done it enough that there was no longer anxiety, but then we still had the habits of doing that. And I realized that I liked the show much better when we were 100% sober, so that we made the transition the other direction, right? And then the occasional now. But I never really felt, I think the YouTube was probably the hardest for me. YouTube is, and still to this day, YouTube is weird.
Yeah.
It's still
kind of awkward.
YouTube and Insta story for me is still awkward as fuck. And I try not to feel awkward when I do it so that it doesn't come off that way. And it's just weird to me talking to a phone by myself, or having like Doug just like videoing us and like talking, like you're talking to potentially tens of thousands or even million people on YouTube, and it just feels weird. Mm. You know, I felt like standing up in front of it, like when we go to like a seminar, or I did that for,
you'd see their eyes and get feedback.
Yeah, and I did that for when we worked at 24. I mean, that was something that was a very regular thing that I had to do, where I had to hold these seminars. So I got really comfortable with standing in front of an audience and talking to people. Plus, I've always been an outgoing person, and you know, I've never been uncomfortable in a situation like that. When I'm getting feedback from people, immediate feedback, like their facial expressions, like you're saying, Justin, and like laughter, or like any that stuff helps me communicate.
Yeah, because then you tweak and alter your messages.
And this is why I think I struggle with InstaStory and YouTube so much, is there's no immediate feedback. As I'm talking and whatever message I'm delivering, it feels weird because I don't know if it's getting through, I'm running on, whatever. You know what I'm saying? Where you get that when you're in a live audience.
Mm-hmm. I learned a big lesson with this a long time ago. Competing in, I did a few competitions in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and I would get really, really hyped.
Oh, that's right. You did say you used to get all.
And then I'd get anxious before the match, and then I'd be exhausted when I'd have the match, and it was all and I wasn't fit, I was in shape, I had prepared probably better than most people because I was a fitness, professional as well, so I knew what to do on that level. But I'd get so hyped and pumped and for a week before the freaking match or matches that then I would get exhausted my first match. And I had this shift where I realized that I should really focus my energy on bringing everything down, because I was already so amped. Mm-hmm. That if I brought myself down through things that were relaxing, like massage and going to bed early and quiet music or even meditation, that I would perform a lot better. So I think you have to identify what your anxiety feels like. If you feel like you're not confident and you feel scared, then you might need a pump up. You might need a confidence boost where you do a power pose, or someone slaps you in the face, or you have some coffee to give you a little bit of motivation. If you're so amped that you end up like you're too much energy, where you feel shaky or you feel like you're going to start talking too fast, then you might need to do the opposite and bring yourself down. So I think you have to identify what kind of anxiety you have. And what Adam's talking about when it comes to practice, I mean, frequent exposure will definitely reduce mm-hmm. your anxiety. This is a very classic technique.
It's
where
like my MO.
If you have a fear of something, the more you do it, the less you're going to be anxious. So if you are going to speak in front of a crowd, practice your speech in front of people over and over and over and over and over again until you just like you know it like the back of your hand. Yeah. That will do a lot to reduce your anxiety, unless you're like me where I get too hyped, in which case practicing over and over and over again only gets me more and more and more amped to the point where then again, it's too much for me. So a lot of times what I'll do is I'll forget. I'll purposely not think about what I'm about to do. And then when I get on, I'm on.
I think you said something really key that actually hit home for me listening to you is understanding where and what you're getting the anxiety from. Like, I remember what caused that anxiety for me was the fear of saying something stupid, right? And I think once I accepted that I'm going to say something stupid, and that's totally okay. And what's the worst thing that's going to happen is someone's going to make fun of me, right? Like, the worst thing's going to happen, I'm going to say something completely stupid, it did not come out right, and everybody is going to make fun of me. And so once you get comfortable with the worst case scenario, then it's not a big deal anymore. Like, I just go in like, fuck yeah, I'm probably going to say something totally inappropriate, something totally stupid. I'm going to misspell something. I'm going to make up a word. I'm going to say something that's someone, and then people are going to totally make fun of me for that. So?
Yeah.
So what? Like, so the fuck what? What does that mean? Is that I think that's what you have to decide what, or figure out what is it that is causing the anxiety, and then just be okay with it. Like, you know, I you talk about like going into a judo match or going into a fight with somebody, like, what is the absolute worst thing to happen? You get beat. You lose, right? You get beat. So what? Because you know what? If you get beat, you're going to be better the next time, right? Because you're going to learn from that mistake. The same thing, I approach the same thing with presenting or talking or getting on YouTube or doing these weird things, is I'm probably going to say something stupid. Mm-hmm. Someone's going to make fun of me. That's great, because I'm going to get that out of the way, and then I won't do that again. Yeah. I'm going to do it. You know what I'm saying? And so when you start to embrace the worst thing that could potentially happen in this scenario that you're heading into and accept it and anticipate it, then I think you get more comfortable with it.
Yeah, which is funny because some people will like kind of think about those things like worst case scenario, but then they just dwell on those worst case things, right?
Like that's so bad.
Like they can't they can't back out of that and like realize that, that's worst case scenario. That's not necessarily a given,
right?
You know, and so you just have to put yourself out there and be okay with it.
Like, and even if it does, who cares?
Who cares? Like, yeah, you're gonna run, whatever, dude. Like you're gonna survive. Like everything's gonna be fine. And obviously, like this has been like an uncomfortable thing, but this has been the MO is the exposure. You know, it's the more times you do things, then it all kind of comes together. You get more comfortable with it. You don't have those same feelings anymore. Like you literally can numb those feelings. And I remember the most anxious I think I've been was mainly when I would get on stage and I was going to play music because like I think it was like you're saying, I was so overly amped. And it was just like, finally I get to like, play this cool thing in front of these people and all these people. And like, I would actually get to the point where my fingers would like lose strength and I would like lose the pick like all the time. And I'd just be like, and like making horrible noises. Like, no, it's happening again. And I had to start like just breathing and really work on that because it would mess me up. Like my performance would drop out there.
I think the whole accepting the you're gonna fuck up deal and it's going to eventually get bad sometimes is and being okay with that because that's what makes success and nailing it so more awesome because you've failed before and you fucked up and you've been nervous and you've been scared and people made fun of you and this and that. So when you do nail it and when you do win, and then there's so much more. If all you ever do is win and every time you do something, you'll say all the right things and you're so perfect about everything you do, it loses its luster, right? Mm-hmm. So there's beauty in the fuck up. There's beauty in the failing. There's beauty in all that because when you succeed, it makes it that much better.
That's what's so interesting to me to watch like Conor McGregor. Just the way that he carries himself with so much confidence and like having the vision already established and like seeing, all the steps it takes to get to this point, but putting himself out to fail.
Right.
And then literally rebounding or just like, like enjoying the process of it and being like, well, I'll put myself now in this situation and I'm going to tackle it.
Right.
It doesn't matter if I win or lose. He's not going to talk about losing. He's like very focused on prevailing, but at the same time, he's doing it. He's in there,
right,
where everybody else won't do it because they can't take the failure part.
Right.
I'll tell you what's fascinating is, now we're doing some of these vlogs and stuff on YouTube, and we've done a few of them, and Justin totally shines. You totally shine when you're being funny and you're by yourself on camera. It's a completely another fucking level of Justin that I've never seen. Like,
that's the only place I've ever felt comfortable. It's weird.
And it comes out like there's that one vlog, I think we aired it, right, where he was doing the funny things at the table and he's hiding and all this stuff.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, this is a whole fucking level of Justin that I've never seen where you're just like your pure, I guess your talent comes out. For me being funny on camera, that's when I feel anxious. If I'm informing, I'm like on fire. I have no problem. Or if I'm debating, I'm on fire. No problem. Tell me to be funny. Like, okay, Sal, you need to be funny right now. I'm not going to be funny. And I can be funny, but it's usually on accident. It's not trying to be.
Right, right.
Yeah. When you do your thing on camera, it's like, what is the difference between that and other stuff where you
so
feel...
Weird. Yeah, I don't know. Like it, I don't know. I think it's... that's been with me ever since childhood. You know, it's like when I'm around like a group of guys or just a group in general, I feel like this need to entertain and do something to kind of shake it up and be funny or do something crazy. Like I will like put myself on blast for some reason. Like that to me feels rewarding, and so I've definitely always tried working on that, like unintentionally, but like I've noticed that that's like my go-to. Like I want to like, I want to establish that, so it's like that's something I can do. I can add this.
See, it seems to me that that we take for granted that they're all skills, and we tend to think that I'm just good at this one and I'm not good at that one.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I think like if I could take the confidence that I have, because I don't have anxiety. If you tell me to inform or debate on a subject or whatever, discuss, or even if I'm leading and I'm telling, you know, I have a crew and I'm doing a meeting like that, I have zero fear, zero anxiety. It's all fire. It's all awesome. Again, if you tell me to be funny or perform or do improv or something like that, all of a sudden I'm this nervous, you know, anxious, not confident individual. But I think there is a way where I could take how I feel about one thing and transfer to the other, because I know if I felt the same way, I'd probably be good.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? So it's kind of, it's interesting that we're talking about this, because I'm kind of having a little bit of an epiphany about it where I know I feel good doing this, but not this. And why? What's the big fucking deal? I can have that same feeling.
Well, why is it? Why is this any different than the last question where we talked about kids and the genetics that they have, right? This is the same type of, same idea here, right? You have kids where the genetic component is always going to play a big role, but it doesn't mean you can't start early or practice and practice and practice to get better, right? Like, so if you don't have the natural ability to, you know, get in front of the camera and be funny, then it's not, you just genetically aren't built that way. You're better at informing. Sure. It's a natural gift, which we all knew the minute you turned the camera on.
Mm-hmm.
You had a knack for the green screen and you could just get on there and you could talk and be very, very informative. You talk with a lot of empathy. That's a talent of yours you have. Plus you've continued to, you know, work at it and get better and better. So you really excel at it. But then you have this other side where you've never really had, you've never gave two shits about being funny or being a comedic, you know, on the show or, you know, in front of camera. So you haven't really practiced that. But I bet you if you approach that, you practice it, you could get pretty damn good. That's why, who were we just talking to? Oh, it was Jay when we went down and recorded with him. And he said one of the best things he ever did was enrolling in the improv class.
Yep.
He says that has
Doug has said that several times.
Yeah.
He said that would be a smart thing for us to do.
And you know, and it's, and we talk about it. God, fuck, I wish we had more time because it's something that we for sure, I think.
You know, we
do.
Could have someone come in here, dude, and do it here.
We've talked about that. I think that, you know, those type of things, right? So, you know, this going back to the original question of performance anxiety, I think it does matter what we're talking about here. I think we joked about it sexually. I'm assuming that this person's talking more about sports and getting on the mic and doing things like that. And to me, it's like, you know, embracing the failures.
Well,
man.
Hey, even sexually, like,
right.
You're way more likely to have anxiety the first few times you have sex with someone
than
after you've been with them for.
Right.
You know, I had buddies who, I actually, one of my, I'm not going to say who this person is, because if I say how I'm related to them, whatever, they'll know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
But they were in a long relationship. Then they got out of a relationship, young dude, healthy, whatever, met up with this girl, super attracted to her. They liked each other. They go to have sex. And for the first time in his entire life, at the time, he was probably 27 or 28, so he's young. He's like, he goes, I've never, like, not been able to get like a full on boner. He's like, that's never happened to me. He goes, is my testosterone low? It's happened like two times in a row. And it's just because he was fucking nervous.
Like three quarter?
What
are we working with here? You know what I mean?
He was fucking nervous. And afterwards, he's like, yeah, man, once I got comfortable, like, I was okay.
Right, yeah.
So it's the same thing. Like, practice. And eventually.
Sometimes pregame.
Yeah. And eventually. Yeah. You'll get a boner.
There it is. There's your advice.
Start warming it up.
Hey, check it out. Go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. It's our channel on YouTube. A new video every single day. We mix them up. We have informational videos, and we've got some vlogs that are going up now, too, where you can kind of see what's happening behind the scenes here at Mind Pump Media Studios. Also, if you want to ask us a question that we answer on an episode like this one, the place to do it is Instagram. The page to do it on is Mind Pump Media. We also have personal pages. Mine is Mind Pump Sal, Adam is Mind Pump Adam, and Justin is Mind Pump Justin.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now, plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.